So from now on, we'll introduce you to the Future Gateway, one component to provide user interfaces for final users. And this presentation is split in three PowerPoint slides. The first, the one I'm going to introduce now, is just an overview of the system. Then we will go deep inside to the API exposed by this environment. And the third slide is the one containing a little practice section that me and my colleague Mario will show you afterwards. So here you are, the outline of the topics covered by this first set of slides showing the overview of the Future Gateway. And what is the Future Gateway? The Future Gateway is a framework that is that aims to create science gateways. I don't know if any of you knows or heard about Future Gateways before. A science gateway is there exists a definition given by the TerraGrid XSED. It's a community developed set of tools, applications, and data, normally integrated via a portal or a suite of applications, providing a user interface and further customized to meet a specific scientific need. So from this definition, we can see some words highlighted here. So the Science Gateway is meant to serve a community. It is talking about applications, tools, some cooperative means, and of course provide a graphical user interface to serve such community. The Future Gateway itself is not a really new product. It's an evolution of another existing framework that maybe some of you could know, and that is the Catania Science Gateway framework. The most important target that Future Gateway is trying to reach is to improve the weakness identified from this earlier system. For instance, we tried to provide an easy mechanism to install the environment or maintain this environment over time. So for instance, we have the possibility to install the Future Gateway with the installation scripts. You can also participate to coding of this component just because all source codes are on GitHub. And its architecture is thought to be easily customizable. This because, as you remember in the Science Gateway definition, it is important to meet community needs, you know, while providing a Science Gateway. It also provides a flexible and uniform access to distributed computing services. And this is accomplished by mainly by the JSAGA library. SAGA is a standard created to target distributed application on distributed infrastructure. And but this with the Future Gateway, there are defined the so-called executor interfaces. So we are providing a way to customize the standard behavior of the future gateway accordingly to the specific targeted distributed infrastructure that you may have. Another point is that we are providing a solution that is totally portal independent. What does mean? In the Catania Science Gateway framework, we were proposing a specific portal technology. But normally, communities may have already a portal serving already their science. And in such, with the future gateway, you don't need anymore to use our suggested portal solution. We also concentrated to give a solution to make the development of application as easy as possible. This is accomplished by adopting the RESTful API solution. And we know maybe already that REST APIs are very important to develop quite easily any kind of network application. So on this slide, we can see the two different approaches. The one on the left is the classic Catania Science Gateway framework approach. We can see inside the big box is the Liferay portal technology proposed at that time. Under this portal, we have different portlets. Portlets are the graphic user interface for the portal users, providing application interfaces, ways to move or deal with user files. And portlets are linked to the so-called grid engine. The real name of this component is the grid and cloud engine. It's an internal engine that is in charge to interact with the distributed infrastructures, so to physically access on behalf of the user to the physical infrastructure. And the grid engine will use this old name because you will see it in the source codes or in the configuration parameters. So the grid engine was tightly linked with JSAGA. And JSAGA is a Java library in charge to physically access to the distributed infrastructure. On the right side, you can see the differences with the Catania Science Gateway framework and the Future Gateway. So portlet, in this case, are not anymore linked with the grid engine directly, but they are only using REST APIs. And REST APIs are pointing to the so-called API server that you can see highlighted in the red box, in the bordered red box. The API server is then contacting the grid engine in order to execute user requests on the distributed infrastructure. But the API server has a modular shape. It can also interact with any other SAGA implementation, for instance, or any other module in order to target the distributed infrastructure. This is can be seen better here. We have under the zooming inside the API server box, we have two components. We have on top the API server front-end that is a system that is in charge to get users' API. The front-end is just filling a queue that is stored on a database table. And then we have the second component, the API server daemon, that polls over this database table and execute any user request processing the record inserted by the front end. During the processing of the queue entries, the API server is instructed to target the specific executor. So one record may require to ask a job submission to the grid engine, or it can involve other modules. For instance, in the box, in the slide, we have that simple task that is another executor interface that will be shown later. Another architecture view is this one. We have on the left side the mobile and web applications communicating with the API front-end through the REST APIs. The front-end is communicating, is exchanging through the queue information with the API server daemon. The API server daemon is just polling on the queue table. You can see the task queue, in the yellow box, the task queue table. The API server is interacting with the specific target executor, so for instance, the grid engine, the simple task, or even other. The grid engine interface is communicating with, of course, the grid engine. The grid engine will communicate with JSAGA. JSAGA itself is using other components named the adapters that are in charge to interact with the distributed infrastructure. With other interfaces, you can target any kind of other middleware, APIs. For instance, you can use Python Saga, or you can even target a command line execution. So this is totally independent from the API point of view. So this should target as much as possible the flexibility of the future gateway in respect with the previous architecture provided by the Catania Science Gateway framework. So we have the future gateway is composed by those two important components. We have the API front-end that in the source codes is identified as FG API server. It's a Python code using the Flask micro framework. The choice to use Flask has been taken because this Flask framework is providing a very friendly way to expose API, RESTful APIs. And it is also very easy to customize the API behavior. The front end is contacting MySQL database, and this database is not only dealing with the queue, but it also provides information about application of the Science Gateway, parameters of the application of provided by the Science Gateway, information about application input and output files, and then tasks, information about tasks that are submitted applications, and of course, at the end, the queue. The second component is the API server daemon. It's a Java servlet, and it's a daemon that executes on Tomcat as application, as a web application. This daemon is timely polling over the task queue, and it is responsible to implement the request provided by the user with the API, with the REST API. So at the moment, the API server is capable just to target the grid and cloud engine interface. So we can, for instance, with this component, we can send jobs on a standard grid environment, a Glite MEI, for instance. But this also provides a way to submit jobs via SSH to a cluster, for instance, or with the ROCCI interface, we can execute jobs inside a cloud environment, exploiting the OCCI standard. And then recently has been developed for Indigo to meet Indigo needs, the simple Tosca. It's a simplified version that is targeting the Tosca component. And Tosca is the orchestrator component that has been shown by my colleague explaining the Indigo project before than me. Jacinto Donvito, sorry. So let's focus on the front end. It's all source code of this component are available on Git. You can see the link. As I told you, it's a Python code exploiting the Flask micro framework. You have also a link here for this framework. The meaning of this component is just listen for API REST calls specified by user applications and specification defined by the API of the APIs are available under the link highlighted. There are two ways to execute the API server frontend. You can run it as a standalone service, so just type Python and the command line for this component and the server will run, will listen for API calls. Or you can configure WSGI, for instance, in Apache to run this service. Again, the service needs a database. We decided to adopt MySQL. And as I told you, this database is in charge to store also applications, the files, all information related to the application, the tasks, and also users that are using the APIs. And of course, there are also defined groups and roles for each group. The second component is a servlet that is running as a daemon. This component is written in Java because, for instance, we have the intention to use JSAGA as a component. JSAGA is written in Java, and so the best way was to target the JSAGA libraries using Java code. The daemon is polling the task queue, and as soon as one command is inside the queue, the daemon flag it as in processing, and will target the specific executor interface to run the command. There is also another task performed by the API server, daemon. It's a really simple mechanism to check timely the executed commands. There is a very simple mechanism to retry failed requests. And as soon as the number of failed requests reaches a threshold, then will be marked as failed and reported to the administrator. The daemon is also providing a kind of control panel. This is not really mature, and at the moment it's just providing configuration information. This part needs further developments.